Chris is out there. Coach Stewart is, you don't know Coach Chris Stewart, he's the coach of the Athens High School baseball team, and I'm an assistant varsity coach, volunteer at Trimble High School. And back in the 70s, I was head coach there, and I've done a number of different things since. I was out of baseball for quite a while in terms of the high school scene, but always stayed involved in the American Legion. I did a summer collegiate baseball team where we tried to get as well NAIA Division III. We had some D1 players, some D2 players, etc. And have coached at a lot of different levels, but got interested in this topic. I got involved and interested in this topic because, one, I knew we were going to have some pretty good freshmen coming up at Trimble, and we'd had over the years, you know, some players that went on to play at another level. Way back in the 70s, I was real fortunate, you know, first D1 player, ended up being an All-American at Ohio University and drafted by the Yankees. And I remember that process, how cumbersome it was and how difficult it was just getting noticed, someone with that much talent. But it wasn't real obvious, for he was kind of a sleeper kid, not a real big kid, got stronger as a woman. We'll talk about a lot of this kind of thing. Then I went through the process with my own son back in the late 90s. But it's a whole new ballgame, and that's where, you know, Coach Stewart comes in, because, you know, he's just gone through it recently with his son. You can tell he's a lot younger than I am, at least a couple of years younger than I am. And with social media and that kind of thing, it's just a whole new process that can be daunting, can be confusing even at times. And so Coach and I had a discussion a year or so ago, and I asked him if he, you know, does anything with college recruiting. He mentioned that he sends out some things to his players, and I said, you know, anyway, somehow it came out that we thought maybe a seminar like this, because I have a friend right now, starting at 6 o'clock, from 6 to 8 every Sunday, he's going to 4 straight seminars, and shelled out $300 for the seminar, and you'll find these all over the place. Now maybe, you know, get $300 of quality, you know, information, I'm sure. So, but we decided that, you know, this would be nice to offer it for nothing, because, you know, if you go through this process right, you'll encounter a lot of expense. You can encounter a lot of expense, and we'll talk about that. But from my perspective, I think it can be a very positive thing. You know, my son going to college and went 5.5 hours away, and he played Division III baseball, and he got a great education, and it was one of the best times of our lives. We traveled all over the country, and it was a quality program, a top 25 program, but going through that process was very interesting. So no matter what people tell you, you'll get some good information from people, and you'll get some that may not be so good. But it can be a very positive experience, and our hope would be that, you know, we would create an awareness of the fundamental process of being recruited to play college baseball. Some of this, you know, can apply to other sports as well, but that's the primary goal as I see it. Plus that you'll understand words like fit, you know. It should be a good fit. Your college choice should be a good fit for you academically, and athletically, and financially, and socially. All those things have to come into play. If you get to a college and you're not happy with it, and you're strapped financially, or there's something about the college you don't like, you've made a, you know, it makes it difficult to stay. So fit is important. And the other thing I would say before I turn it over to Chris is the whole idea of recruiting, it's a verb, it's an action word, and it's really a two-sided deal. you know, people think, well, how, you know, I've got to be seen, I've got to get noticed, how do I do that? And we can talk about that tonight. But the onus really has got to be on you and your parents. Don't wait for a whole bunch of contacts maybe out there from college coaches, because they're waiting to hear from you as well. They're very, very, very busy people. And of course, they're in, it's a business with them too, so they want good recruits. But you can sell yourself, market yourself, and there's a big difference between, you know, first of all, you got to be seen. That's kind of interesting process. And then you have to be noticed. You see the difference? Being seen, being noticed is, okay, what kind of athlete are you? What kind of skills do you bring to my program? So I'm probably not telling you something you don't already know, but you have to keep this thing in, because my experience has been that people wait to be noticed and it gets too late. Here comes the sophomore year, the junior year, the senior year, and you know, that phone hasn't rang, that email hasn't come. You know you're noticed if you start getting personal communication going with you and the coach at the school, right?
Yeah.
So, So don't be as concerned about how many contacts you get, but be concerned about the coaches that want you. That's really key. So, with that.
Well, I just, instead of saying some of the same things, I'll just go ahead and bounce off of what Steve said. And first of all, I'll tell you a little bit about my own experience in this. I'm just off, right off the heels of having, like you said, gone through it with my own son. And he was actually committed to Alderson Broaddus, the shirt that I'm wearing right now. We went from August to the end of November, this past fall, late summer, fall. We went to 5 different states, just about every week we were going somewhere, it seemed like, between South Carolina, Pennsylvania, Ohio, West Virginia, and Indiana, primarily is where we focused our visits. And I'll explain to you how, you know, later on how we decided which schools to go to, because that's an important piece here that we're going to talk about. But after that whole, you know, to make a long story short and a bunch of stories combined into a conclusion here, after that little tour that we took of colleges, one, he had a lot of good experiences. We had a lot of good experiences together in the car. And while we were there, and some of those we spent the night, some of them we did not. We just drove, visited the school, did the tour, did the workout, met the coaches, met some professors, things like that, and then came back home. And then I went to work the next morning, which was actually that morning. And it seems like a tiring process, and it is at the time, but I look back on it now and I kind of miss that. It's that part is over. And probably my daughter says she wants to play softball, so we'll probably go through that with her as well, which will be pretty cool and a lot of fun. But when we were done with the whole thing, you know, Brock has been wanting to play baseball in college since, for as long as I can remember, he's been saying that. And I knew that it wasn't just going to happen. There were lots of reasons, things he had to work on personally to get to the college level, and things that I had to encourage him to take ownership of. And there were times when I just finally had, you know, I sat down with him in the middle of his junior year and said, "You're not going to play in college. You're not disciplined enough. There's no way that you're going to play in college, because you, college baseball is a job. It's something that you're going to have to commit. The commitment is so much bigger. And right now you're too much into just enjoying playing baseball. And I want you, if it's not enjoyable, then you shouldn't be doing it. But if you want to get to the next level, it takes a lot of work, a lot of preparation. And so my wife's name is April, we sat down with him and we said, we've already put a lot of energy into helping you, you know, reach what we assume is your dream and your goal. I don't want this to be something that's my dream and my goal. I've played college baseball, and I don't need to go through this again just to drag you along. If it's not something you want to do, I'm okay with it. We were okay with it. If you want to go a whole different route, he plays guitar also, if you want to play music, we'll be absolutely fine with that. I still love baseball, I'll still coach baseball, and we'll love you, and that's okay with us. And he said, "No, I absolutely want to, I really do want to play." And we said, "Well, you got to do what it takes to get there." And so he got real serious about it. And actually, one of the decisions that he ended up making this year, which was a really hard one for him, he went in and sat down with the head football coach. And after being at every workout in the summertime and all the preseason camps and things like that, when it came down to the first day of practice, he said, I am concerned that I'm not where I need to be to reach one of my big goals in life, which is to play college baseball. I've not had any offers. I've not had anybody look at me. I talked with a couple coaches this past summer, but I've got to get to work, and that means the fall, unfortunately, is the biggest time for prospect camps and visits and things like that of your junior and senior year. He was in his senior year. He's a senior this year. And so Coach Adams understood, and I will say that in our context, I would not encourage people to go that route. That's why I would encourage you, if you're younger, to start early, because you don't have to stop playing other sports. You should play other sports. But for him, in his context, he did play other sports until his senior year, and now this year it's just baseball, so that he could focus on it in the fall, doing what we did and taking that tour of college campuses and things. And so when it was all said and done, he ended up with four total offers. One was a guaranteed walk-on offer at Coker College in South Carolina, which is a Division II school. And then three scholarship offers. Two of them were NAIA scholarship offers from Union College in Kentucky, which is about 5 hours from here. Really small campus, small school, but it was a really good baseball program. We actually really enjoyed our time there. And Indiana Tech, which is also an NAIA school over in Fort Wayne. Two very different communities. Union's about 800 people, Indiana Tech's in Fort Wayne. And just so two different kinds, very, very impressive campus. I mean, I work in a new building, you work in a new building, and I love what Scripps College has to offer. Indiana Tech blew it away. I mean, it was the technology, how modern everything was. I told Brock, when it was all said and done, like, you know, if I were doing it again, I'd go to Indiana Tech, just because I loved the campus and everything. But the best offer that he received, which became the best fit for him when it was all said and done, was Alderson Broaddus, a Division II school in Philippi, West Virginia. Thankfully, only 2.5 hours away. It was the closest school of all the schools that we visited. And I'll tell you why he visited the schools that he did. One, the big reason why is because he already knows what he wants to major in. So that took the pool of schools and it narrowed it down. I mean, from, you know, if you just want to go in and be a college student and figure out what your major is, you got every school in the nation, you know, is part of your pool. He wants to major in exercise science, exercise physiology. So that took our filter down to these schools. And one example would be he did receive contact from the coach in Millersville, in Pennsylvania, which is they were actually ranked at one point last year number one in the nation in Division II baseball. They ended up three when it was all said and done. Millersville is a phenomenal baseball school. It's a small town directly located in the middle of Baltimore, Atlantic City, and Philadelphia. And so his recruitment base is mostly over in that area, but he'd been reaching over into Ohio a little bit, and particularly on the eastern side of Ohio. And so we were going to schedule a visit there. We had a visit ready to go, and I said, you know, Brock, you need to get online to make sure that they've got exercise science. Got online, looked at the academic catalog, they didn't have exercise science. And so I waited for him to tell me, you know, because he was all excited about the visit. It was actually going to be the first visit we were going to take. And he said, we probably shouldn't go there, should we? And I said, you're absolutely right, we shouldn't go there. We're not driving 6 hours to visit a school that you're not going to go to because you already know what you want to major in. And so that was a good learning experience for both of us. So anyway, let's jump in. I think we could tell you a lot of things. I could tell you a lot of stories, but we want to get into the meat of this. And this is kind of what we're going to, this is the whole thing tonight. This is what we're going to look at, and we want to make sure that we leave plenty of time for question and answers. So the next slide that I'm going to show you is, we're going to talk about all of the, is everybody here for baseball? Maybe there's other, I mean, because all of our information is about baseball. Although it could also you got a pretty good opportunity to play golf
in
college. A very good opportunity to play golf. In fact, if you're a female, and I found out I think I talked to somebody here at OU about it. If you're a female and you play golf, they're looking for people to give money to, scholarships to. It's really an incredible thing. And that's what the school is funded with, with scholarships for that. Not just because you're a D1 school or D2, just because you have the opportunity to have scholarships doesn't mean that your school determines that we're going to fund this program with scholarships. Indiana Tech was fully funded, Union was not. Indiana Tech, that when being fully funded means that NAIA schools have the ability to give 12 full ride scholarships. They never give full ride scholarships. You're not going to get a full ride to play baseball. No one is. They divide them up among the players they decide they want to give them to. Indiana Tech may have been fully funded. That means they had 12 fulls at their disposal. They could use it however they want. Union only had 9. That's what the school determined that they wanted to give them. And so it just depends, on what the school wants. The governing body, the NAIA and the NCAA, determines the cap. Like Division I for NCAA is 11.7. But again, we'll get into that. Let's go to that right now. I don't need to do this overview. We'll get there. This was done in 2015. Those numbers haven't changed a whole lot since then. I tried to find a more recent census, but this gives us a pretty good idea when it comes to doing the math about playing in college. All right. On the left side there, we have all the different divisions that offer baseball. And it doesn't mean all the schools offer baseball, but those are the divisions that you might find that you could play baseball in. And so the number of schools in 2015 in each of those divisions are in the next column, and then the number of teams on those schools, the number of baseball teams in those schools, and then the number of men. It was all men that played baseball in 2015. I'm assuming it still is that way. And then the average size of the team, and then the limit of scholarships. That's what this limit per team is, the athletic scholarships that they're limited to, and then the average amount of money that is given in those scholarships. So like in D1, there are 299 teams in 2015, which meant about 10,489 men were playing Division I baseball. Do any of you have any idea how many high school seniors or just high school boys play baseball in the United States? I don't have the exact number. It's 90 some thousand. It's an incredible number. So a very, very, very small percentage play it's actually more than 90 some thousand, but very, very small percentage play Division I. D2 is very comparable in numbers, 269 with 10,356 that played in that year. And then look at the two largest divisions where people play baseball. And the reason I'm pointing this out is because a lot of people fail to look into Division III because they hear they don't give scholarships. And so they don't play Division III, or they assume that Division III is much lesser quality baseball than Division II or Division I. And it just isn't true. And I'll give you some examples of why I know that is a fact. But the majority of people who play baseball in the country play Division III, which means they're not playing on scholarship. In fact, the majority of players that play college baseball aren't playing on scholarship, even if the school itself offers scholarships. I think there's one chair here. You might want to grab a couple chairs out there. I think there's some open ones there. Guys, NAIA is a really growing governing body also that offers scholarships, and I'll go ahead and go over to this column. I mentioned that D1 offers 11.7 full ride scholarships. I believe this is true. I know it was true, and I think it's still true, that for D1s to be able to offer a scholarship to someone, there is a minimum that they have to offer, which is 25%. And so they will typically start at 25% with someone, unless this is some kind of stud that everyone, LSU's after or Florida's after, and then that guy's probably going to get a greater offer. He may even get a full. I mean, like a guy like Bryce Harper may get offered a full ride if you're guaranteed to be a Division I or a Round 1 draftee. they want to get those guys on their teams to play in college, because once they get them to a four-year school, they're locked in for 3 years in baseball. You can't get drafted. You can't go outside of after your junior year. And so that's the number, the total number that every Division I school is capped at if they're fully funded. Again, just because it's a D1 school doesn't mean that they have all those scholarships available to them. You just have to ask, are you fully funded? And that's not something you want to ask in your visit, all right? At least not up front. D2, the maximum number of scholarships that they give are 9. And 9, if you're fully funded, they cap those schools off at 9 full ride scholarships. A lot of these D2 schools and D3 schools, D2, since they are offering scholarships, a lot of D2 schools end up being a lot more expensive, your smaller private colleges. The school that Brock's going to is not real expensive. It's about $36,000 a year. And so, as you can see, even the average amount that's given is that, so you're still coming up with some money to pay for school. No one's going to play baseball. No one's going to school for free because of baseball. I will say that we were fortunate to get quite a bit more than that. I was really proud of the offer that he was given. But it's still not a full ride. When you add up the academics, and the merit scholarship with the baseball, he's still getting, it's about 82%. So we still got to come up with some money for him to go. D3, Marietta. I'm thinking of the schools in Ohio. D3, is Muskingum D3?
Yeah,
Muskingum, Marietta. I know Dominican's 2, Otterbein D3, right? Your son went to D3, right?
He went to D3.
Case Western Reserve. Denison. These are some really incredible schools.
Kenyon
College, right? I mean, they're Ohio and Pennsylvania and Virginia are hotbeds for college baseball. Capital, Wittenberg, Worcester, Heidelberg. There we go. We're getting into them now. These are all, this past summer, the team that Brock played for this summer played on a lot of these campuses that we just mentioned. These are beautiful campuses. Denison is unreal. I mean, it's unbelievably beautiful. Wittenberg, Worcester is a very beautiful campus. You're thinking, well, how can he go there? Well, ACT, grades, GPA, they will find ways to find some money to get, merit scholarship, athletic scholarships, things like that. And the baseball coach will help with that. He will help with that.
Well, from a lot of D3 campuses.
And you have more experience with this.
On a lot of the D3 campuses, they try to get you into what they call ED, early decision, because you have to get all your stuff together academically in order to get in, and the coach is really a great recruiting source for these D3 schools. Most of them have great academic reputation, so you've got to get your academic stuff in. And the coach is probably more involved, I think, in some ways at that Division III level to try to get you in and get you locked in early.
Mm-hmm.
And I knew my son wasn't probably a D1 baseball player, but he just had this intense love of the game, and I was really fortunate that he was a very good student. So I happened to know that he ended up 5.5 hours away from where we live, clear out in Terre Haute, Indiana. And there was a place called Rose Holman. And I only knew about that because we had a teacher back in the 70s when I was teaching. And her son was a very, very smart kid who started in our school district and ended up going to Rose Holman. So that always stuck in the back of my mind because I knew what kind of kid he was. Now so he went to Rose Holman. It sounds like your grandma, doesn't it? Rose Holman. I mean, nobody's heard of Rose Holman. But if you get on their website, and not bragging, but for 20 years in a row, they've been the top undergraduate engineering program in the country. And if you're in Indiana, both of my adult kids live in Indiana, So he met a lot of nice people out there and met his future wife. And they have four boys and live in Indiana. But when I looked at it, just to get your wheels churning a little bit, so he wanted a good academic challenge, he wanted a good program. So we start making a spreadsheet. Back then, you know, we were kind of doing by hand and
all
that.
We still did by hand this year. Yeah. I had him do the same thing.
But you look and see, okay, what kind of major do they have? He wanted to be an engineer. The whole school is our engineers. So check, you know, how much money was it? Well, we had, you know, that was kind of mind-boggling, the money. Again, he was a pretty good student, so he did pretty well, you know, getting some money for academics. And then at D3, now back in the day, my day, and not too long after that, if a lot of D3 programs, you know, the football coach might be the baseball coach, and the facilities were maybe okay. Well, it's really not that way anymore. I look to see, do they have, just to get your mind moving on some of this, do they have a fall program? That would tell me something about their program. It would be rare not to have one that didn't have a fall baseball program. What are their facilities like? You know, what are the coach's credentials? Where'd he come from? You know, what's his kind of style? And all those things came out very positive. And if you check at Rose Holman, it's a school that I say most people don't know about. They're generally in the top 25 in the nation in Division III, and they played the Marietas. And when we went out there, the facility was a foot of snow on the ground. I thought, my gosh, it's a long way away. I mean, it's miserable out here. And we looked at the facility. You couldn't see the field, of course, because it had snow all over it. The field house wasn't anything to write about. The coach says, you know, next fall, when he comes, we'll have a new sports complex up, and they did, and we got an okay from the president. We wanted to really enhance our baseball facilities. Now they host regional NCAA D3 games, and it took him, by the time he was a senior, they finally got the lights installed. They have a beautiful place. So the point of that whole story is, don't be, because it may be a Florida or an OU or an Ohio State or a Michigan, you may not be hearing from them. Don't limit yourselves, because the one constant in this whole thing, when I look around the table, is that you must be hardworking young baseball players that are good teammates. That will never change, you know, and that's just got to be a given. So it doesn't make any difference what level you are. Those kinds of things you can market every single day.
Yeah.
And we both have stories about people that, you know, if you do get a coach, if you're ever lucky enough to get them to come to the games, because guess what? You play when? In the spring. When do the college coaches play? In the spring. They're probably not going to come watch you play in the spring. Mm-hmm. But if you're lucky enough to get them to come at all, and we'll talk about some of those opportunities, they're going to look at how you take the field and all that. I've had stories where they come to look at one kid and they'll say, hey, who's that other kid there? Yeah. I really like the way he conducts himself. And I'm looking, you know, I was telling Coach the other day, you know, we had a coach that was at one of our Legion games years ago, and he came to look at one kid and he said, hey, I really like the way he conducts himself. And I just got word yesterday that my shortstop is leaving college, because, you know, he's leaving college for a certain reason, and I don't have him. So you never know when this whole picture changes. Mm-hmm. You know, so hang in there. And you're going to hear some things that might be overwhelming today, but that's what we want. And we're glad there's a lot of young people here, because you've got time to work through some of this stuff.
Yeah, definitely. Moving down the list there, the USCAA and their other 4 years, that's just a column to show you that there are other divisions, that there are other collegiate bodies that have baseball. Some of them may give scholarships, some of them may not. but there's a lot of college baseball out there. And so at that time in 2015, and it's growing, I mean, there's more teams that are popping up that are in the USCA. I think Kent State has a, not Kent State, Wright State has a team. It's not Wright State, it's Wright State. It's a satellite school, like OUL, OU, Chillicothe, that kind of school. Those, a lot of those satellite schools have baseball and they just play in one of these other governing, one of these governing bodies. Whether it's scholarship or not, it's an opportunity to play baseball. One of the best options for baseball for guys in our area, I believe, especially for people that may struggle academically a little bit, that may not be, maybe you need a couple more years to get to learn how to be a good student before you go to college, is junior college. And that's what NJCAA stands for. And you'll hear us say the word JUCO. JUCO just means junior college. So J-U-C-O stands for junior college. And then the CCCAA is another junior college division, basically two-year schools. In our area, in Ohio, I'll tell you, there are four really, really highly competitive junior colleges. There are more than four in Ohio, but I'll start with what was probably the least competitive. Owens, Lakeland. Owens is up in the Toledo area. Lakeland is up in Cleveland area. Tri-C, Cuyahoga Community Colleges, which is in the Cleveland area. Phenomenal baseball there, phenomenal. And probably Columbus State is pretty good too, yeah. Sinclair over in Dayton is a very, very good two-year school. In fact, some of the junior colleges have baseball teams that would beat the socks off of D1 teams because they're full of athletes that are D1 level, but athletically, but academically, they're a 2.4, 2.5 grade point average, which means even though the Kent State coach may really want him, he can't get into the school. I had a player like that on the last time that I coached, when I coached American Legion baseball back in the mid-2000s, there was a player that I had on my team that was phenomenal, one of the best catchers that I'd ever, I mean, probably the best catcher I ever coached, one of them. I mean, phenomenal player. Scott Strickland was at Kent State at the time, saw him play, saw him at the district all-star game, said he definitely would love to have this guy, started going through the process. You know, the first thing they ask is, what did he get on his ACT, what's his GPA, what's he like as a student? So sat down with him and talked with him and got that information. His ACT was a 16, his GPA was a 2.3, and he wasn't a very good student. But he went outside after every day at school and hit the cage in his backyard. He was a really good baseball player, but he wasn't a very good student. And so what happened was, Wheelersburg at that time, at the same time, the same graduating year, had a player that was comparable to him athletically, and the kid was a 3.9, 3.8 GPA with a 25 ACT, and same work ethic, same athleticism. Was a no-brainer for Scott. It's like, Wheelersburg kid went. Here's the other thing. After 1 year of college baseball, the Wheelersburg kid really struggled to hit, struggled a lot. And they figured out there was something wrong with his eyesight, his depth perception. Scott was saying, I don't know if he's gonna actually come back next year. He's really frustrated. So the other kid would have been, that would have been his opportunity right there. As well. So he actually did go to Lakeland for a year and try to become a better college student, things like that. It just wasn't for him. It wasn't for him, so he didn't end up playing baseball. So that's one of those guys I feel like just got lost. You know, phenomenal athlete, Southeastern Ohio, just got lost. And he really, really wanted to play. It wasn't that he didn't have the desire. He wanted to play college baseball. He wanted to play professional baseball. In fact, when he realized that school wasn't his thing, he spent a whole summer going to pro camps and things like that to try to get drafted. And one of the other players on that team did get drafted after that year. And he had the same situation. So JUCO is a really good option. So that's what that is. And what this is here, the size, is the average team size. Varsity rosters could include junior varsity players. Like the team in Indiana Tech had 40-some players, like 44 players, I think, when we watched them practice. And that's because about half of those guys, not quite half, were they had a JV team, and so they called it a developmental team, and some of those guys played a couple years, and they got more opportunities, more reps because they were on the JV team, and then they bumped into a varsity spot later, and a lot of schools are going that route in Division II, D3, and AIA, they're going that route with what they call developmental teams or JV teams, and so. it's up to them how many guys they want to keep on the team. So anyway, a couple of things that we need to talk about is just some real honesty about college sports and high school athletes. We had talked a little bit about the different divisions, but one of the things I want you to know is that the competitive levels, the baseball, I mean, when we think of college baseball, we often think of what you see on TV in, you know, the beginning of June, late April, when you start to see the super regionals and things like that. So we only think that college baseball is LSU and Florida and Ohio State and Louisville and Vanderbilt and those teams. And those are the teams that are filled with rosters of guys that the majority of them are going to get drafted. They're going to play professional baseball. A very, very small percentage of players in the world play professional baseball. And the guys, the teams that get those players are the teams that you see on TV. There is in majority of college baseball, Division I, and I don't have to be the first to tell you, some of you guys probably know this, a couple years ago, it was last year in fact, Ryan Grant came up here and spanked the socks off of Ohio University in a game. NAIA school, Division I school, and the MAC, and it's not unheard of. The gap really isn't that wide in all of these divisions. There is very competitive baseball in all the divisions. And so one thing that means to you is this, is if you, you know, sometimes it's a culture shock when players go from high school to college, because a lot of times the players that play in college played a lot in high school. You started a couple years on your JV team, you were the starter, and you played on your varsity team. And it just depends on where you fit, you know, where you are in the scheme of things in your high school team. Of how many years you play varsity baseball, but it doesn't, just because you don't play varsity, I mean, that, there are kids that have been drafted, you know, that have gone to play college baseball, played 1 year of high school varsity baseball, just because they found themselves behind, you know, just found themselves behind kids that were just as competitive, just a year older than them. That has nothing to do with it. Don't worry about that. In fact, like Steve said, most of these college coaches aren't even going to see you. They're never going to see you play in high school. It just rarely ever happens. So you got to find other ways for them to get to see you. But when you get to college, every player is just as good or better than you, and you got to get used to sitting the bench. You got to get used to maybe not traveling. Saying, you know, even if you're a scholarship player, even if they offer you some money, you may not be on the traveling squad for a couple years. You may have to bust your tail and learn how to play a role. If you're a pitcher, you're never going to hit it in college. Most likely, you could go to, and, you know, like where I went to school, I actually went as a pitcher, but I did get to hit a little bit because they let me play some right field. But every time I pitched, I wasn't hitting. And that's the way it is. And so sometimes you got to think about what you want to do, the commitment level and what to expect. A normal day in the life of a college baseball player is probably getting up at 5 in the morning and going and hitting the weights, lifting. Everybody lifts weights. Everybody gets stronger. And so one of the things we did with our high school team this year is we kind of got them ready for that. We lifted at 6 in the morning, didn't we? This is the way it's going to be. If you want to play later, this is the way it's going to be. And then you're going to hit a little bit, then you got to go figure out your practice, your class schedule. You got to go to class. And as soon as class is over, you have no social life because your social life is the baseball field. You have a 3 or 4 hour practice and then field maintenance. You might have meetings, team meetings. I remember going and sitting down with our whole team in a classroom and going over the mental game and things like that. You may go to eat together, and then you may have a couple hours left in the day to just hang out in the dorm. And your life is college baseball. And you know that's going to be the way it is for any athlete in college. That's the way it is. If you eat, sleep, drink, and breathe baseball, there's nothing better. You'll love it. But that's where a lot of guys get dropped off. They're really good athletes. They got the opportunity to play. They got offers. They decided to go and play baseball. But it was like, I want to do other things. I want a different kind of social life. Baseball wasn't in their blood. And so that happens. And again, what that means for you, if you go and play, is if you come in with a 2019 graduating class, and there are those guys, you know, let's say you're a pitcher, and they brought in 12 pitchers that year, and you're thinking, I'm never going to get to pitch. But you love baseball, and this other guy, you know, doesn't quite love baseball, or he gets in trouble, or for some reason or another, he decides not to come back. well, that just elevates you even more. And so it just, those intangibles that you don't know about are, they're very possible to happen as well. What college coaches are looking for when recruiting. This was a really good learning experience for me this summer. When Steve talked about being a good fit, that is a very common phrase, that it's got to be a good fit for you, but it also has to be a good fit for them. They're looking to fit you into their program and what they have looking forward this year, next year, the year after, and so there are going to be schools that maybe really, really think that you're a great athlete or whatever. And actually, this is, Brock experienced this. That's why I said that, you know, one of the offers he had was a walk-on. He really felt like he had a great workout at Coker, the South Carolina school. And I felt like he did too. When I was watching him there, it was an invitational workout. There was only like 40 guys there. And then they did a kind of campus tour afterwards, things like that, met with the coaches. And then he got a text from the coach and said, this is what we want to offer you. And here was the thing. He played catcher. They were bringing in this year to their 2016 class, the freshmen this year, they brought in 6 new catchers. One of them, they had already been working out a little bit in the fall. It was late October, beginning of September, so they'd already seen some of these catchers work out, and he knew that one of these freshman catchers was probably going to start by the time he was a sophomore, and they weren't going to allot any money to that position. So they said, we really like you. We really want you to come here, so come as a walk-on. And it was disappointing to him, but that was the reality. That's the way it was. I mean, it was, they didn't need to offer money for his position. It would be a waste for them to do that when they needed to fill in other positions as well. And so it wasn't a good fit for them. And therefore it wasn't a good fit for him either. And so that's part of what happens, you know, knowing what you want to major in and then going and seeing those facilities as well, looking and seeing what kinds of jobs that people get after they get out of that, you know, after they graduate from that school. How does that school help them get a job in their field? Those were the most important things to us when we went to visit. We wanted to make sure that we scheduled academic visits as much as we did athletic visits, the athletic workouts and things like that. We sat with professors in the field that he wants to study. We went and ate in the cafeteria. We looked at a dormitory. We looked at the labs and the classrooms. Walked around the campus. Found the barbecue places to eat at in all the towns because you got to have that and things like that. You know, and just what's life like there and things like that. And those are all part of it. How communication occurs. One of the things I want to say about this is this. Right now, until you are, let's see. Drew, you're a junior, so right now college coaches can contact you. That opened up a couple years ago where September of your junior year, a coach can actively reach out to you. He can call you, he can text you, he can contact you directly. Before that time, if you're, you know, when you're in your freshman year, sophomore year, before you get to that summer of your, between your sophomore year and junior year, it has to be you contacting them. Or the coach will contact a high school coach or an AD and say, I've heard about so-and-so, can you have him call me? I had that happen a couple times, actually. I had a couple coaches contact me back when Ryan and Adam Lerman were coming up through our program, and it was actually before they opened up the rule for them to be able to contact players in their junior year, and it was actually the beginning of their junior year, like right around August of their junior year, and going into September. A couple coaches said, hey, I've heard a lot about these guys. I was actually at the regional football game last year. I could tell they're athletic. I'd like to talk to them. Could you have them give me a call? And so I would let them know, if you want to talk to this guy, give them a call. That's just some of the NCAA rules, all right, that there's a chain of command in terms of communication. But the other thing I'll say about how communication occurs is this, and this is where we get into some of this honesty about college sports and high school athletes. They want to communicate with the kid. So talking to parents, don't do it for them. You will ruin it for them if you do it for them. Coaches want to know how bad you want to play for them. They want to hear you speak. They want to see your emailing skills. They want to hear from you. And this was a point that I strongly emphasized to my son. You guys might, if you want a chair, I think there's some extra chairs out there. You gonna get some kind of things. And then make sure you grab some notes. Oh, they're out there, cool. But I strongly encourage him. Now, it doesn't mean I didn't help him. Like I worded an email and said, what do you think about this? You know, you look it over and you put your own, because it doesn't sound like you, it sounds like me. So you know, here's some ideas of what to put in the email. And we're even gonna give that to you guys tonight. Those examples and things like that. But I never contacted one coach on behalf of my son unless that coach contacted me. And that was an awkward position for me because I'm not only his dad, but I was his high school coach as well. And so what I actually did was I made sure that Brock gave all of his contact, the college coach contacts, his summer ball president's name and the guy that he worked with in summer ball. And I asked that guy, would you speak on his behalf? Because I know they don't want to talk to dad, because I think he's the greatest thing in the world. You think your kids are the greatest thing in the world, and we are very subjective about our kids. And that's just that college coaches aren't dumb. They know that. And they're going to be really honest with you about what they feel the level your child can play at. I remember having a personal workout for a couple of guys at Athens High School at Rando Field. A couple coaches came out, and they watched a couple guys pitch. And these guys were dead set that they were Division I players. They believed they were Division I players. I tried to tell them, don't just lock in your sights on Division I. That's not the best fit for the majority of people. It really isn't. And even for the guys that make it to Division I, they regret accepting that offer because they realize, I'm going to sit for 3 years behind someone and I may get a chance to get in my senior year. Other than that, I'm just going to be working on the field and playing catch and being a bullpen catcher or playing, just going down and throwing the bullpen a little bit. Whatever, and that's just the way it works a lot of times. And so, there are some, I had a guy that went to D1, went to a D1 school, played 1 year there, didn't get to play very much at all, played in one game, and after that he called me and he said, you know what, I'm going to try to transfer. Would you help me try to transfer? And so I talked to his D1 coach. The D1 coach was very, very obliging in saying yes, I will do everything. I'll contact the coach for him. And I'll speak on his behalf. I'll have him come down. He could work out on our field and all that. And so he ended up transferring from D1 to D3. And he loves it. He'll be a senior there this year. And he's played there ever since and has really enjoyed it. It was a better fit. And it's more than likely going to be the better fit for most of us, most of us in Southeastern Ohio. When that workout was over with those guys that the college coaches came out to watch on a personal workout, I listened to the conversation the coach had with the players, and it was humbling. It was very humbling because he said, you got a lot of potential, you have a lot of upside, but right now we've got guys that are college ready. You're not ready to pitch to D1 level yet. You have the body for it, you have the athleticism for it, but I can tell that you haven't played much. They didn't play in the summer. They never played baseball in the summer. They were very athletic. They just never played baseball in the summer. And he told them that. He said, you need more reps. So he recommended junior college. As soon as they heard the word junior college, shut it out. Didn't even consider it. Because there's this mindset that's not good baseball. They're wrong. Yeah, I mean, it's very good baseball.
If you look at the number of players that make it to the big leagues, there's a tremendous number of players that come out of the JUCO ranks. When my wife and I stay in Florida, the nice thing about being retired and good at Florida for 6 weeks, 30 minutes away.
Bryce Harper's one of those.
Jose Batista.
Yeah.
Anyway, the 2015 World Series champs, JUCO champs, are just 30 minutes away, so we've kind of adopted them, so we go up and watch them. And I tell you, it's a pretty tremendous baseball. Half the roster's trying to get drafted, maybe all of them eventually trying to get drafted, but half of them are just there to try to get an instant look for the majors, and the other half are, maybe it didn't pan out, they couldn't get in, as Coach was saying, into a D1 school, so that they're working, on the grades. But and then I look at the roster and I see people from Arizona yeah. State, and LSU, someplace where they're trying to, the coach is glad to have them, and he's working with them. But they are big, physical kids.
And then a lot of those kids end up transferring into a D1 school. Yeah, and there's
three levels,
right.
least within junior college. So again, Chris is laying out a very realistic picture, and knows a lot more about the process than I do. But I do know that if you got it in here. Mm-hmm. And you present yourself well, and you got to be able to play. You got to be able to play. I'm not trying to blow smoke at you, but if those intangibles aren't there, you won't get past some of the hurdles that you'll see early on, or maybe some disappointment by not hearing from a coach or whatever. But believe me, those coaches, they want you to be able to, they want you to communicate with them. And most of the coaches, we'll get back with you.
Yeah.
And those who really want, you'll know. And as I said early on, when I kind of defined that recruiting as a verb, you'll know early on if you're being recruited or not.
One of those honesty things, too, to go back to that point that you're probably thinking the same thing. I don't want to say this stuff to be mean, but just be honest. How many of you have already gotten letters or emails, I should say, saying come to this camp, from a college coach, from a college program, saying here is, I want to invite you, maybe even has your name in the dear so and so, we want to invite you to our prospect camp or whatever. Have you got any of those? When we have you do something that we're going to tell you to do tonight, which is fill out prospect questionnaires online, you're going to start getting hundreds of those emails. That does not mean you're being recruited. That means that they're trying to get your money, all right? They want you to come to their campus and come to their prospect camp, and you do need to make some selections and go to some of those. But a lot of, I burst a couple of dad's bubbles one time because he was sure that his son was being recruited because he was getting a ton of emails, and he showed me these emails, like, man, it's got his name on it and everything, and it's a personal invitation. I want to personally invite you to come to this, and I said, Everybody on our team got that email. Every senior on our team probably got that email, because those are mass emails that they send out, because they've got to do that. They throw a net out, and then they're trying. That's the beginning for you guys. If you're getting those emails, it's not a bad thing. It's a good thing. That means they know you're out there. So understand, that's not being recruited though. Being recruited is when you get a text from that coach personally, or a phone call personally, or your AD says, hey, this coach wants you to call him. That's when you know you're being actively recruited. And that's probably not going to come until you get on their campus, until you do the things that you need to do. You send them video, things like that, that we're going to get into right now. So if you've got a pen and some of that paper, now's probably, we're going to get to the meat of this now. That was all overview, all right? So now this is let's talk about what you need to do. One, NCAA Eligibility Center and NAIA Eligibility Center. That's the, it used to be called the Clearinghouse, the NCAA Clearinghouse. NAIA never really had an eligibility center until last year. They started doing this thing. It's actually an experimental beta thing for them right now, because one of the NAIA schools, Union, that Brock and I went to, we asked about doing the NAIA Eligibility Center, and the recruiting coordinator was like, I don't know that. Don't worry about that. Just talk with me. So that was that. That's probably not really as much needed at this point. If it is, the school will tell you. The coach will tell you. But go online and Google NCAA Eligibility Center, and go ahead and register for that right now. Do it immediately, because it's going to give you an ID number. And if you want to be recruited by any NCAA coach, you're going to need to give them that ID number. And what that's going to do is it's going to walk you through the process of, one, paying $75. It's nothing's free. Paying $75 to sign up. But then they're going to have you send an email, or they're going to have you put your guidance counselor's email in there. They're going to request transcripts. So it's something that you can actually do. And you will then have a section on their website. You will have a profile. When I say you, I'm talking to the player, all right? You'll have a profile on that website, which will be your NCAA profile, your NCAA eligibility profile, which will include your transcripts, and it'll include your ACT scores. If you've not taken that yet, you can always put it on there. You can add anything you need to add. In fact, new copies of your transcripts as well, once you get your grades up. But all of that is going to be something that needs to happen before you can be recruited. That's something that we should have done a lot earlier than we did. I didn't get Brock signed up to NCAA Eligibility Center until this past August. We were way behind on this stuff.
And I think if you get online, they'll tell you that you do it by your junior year, but it's really nice to have it done prior.
Go ahead and get it. There's no reason not to do it now. And ACT and high school classwork. Take the ACT as much as you can afford to take it and as much as you can. We've had our daughter take it, and she didn't do very well on her first one before she was even a freshman in high school because she hadn't had the math yet that the ACT requires you to have. And so she got like a 19, which is still better than my first one I took when I was a junior. This is the most important score. What we found in our recruiting tour was that GPA was not a question that they really asked about a lot, but ACT was, and this is what I found out why. Because GPA, students' GPA at Athens High School you might have a 4.0 at Athens High School, and this person might have a 4.0 at Trimble High School or, Pickerington Central High School or, whatever, and it doesn't mean the same thing. The classes are different, the scales are different. For instance, the valedictorian at Pickerington Central High School may be middle of the pack at Trimble High School. Your valedictorian may be brilliant, and theirs maybe wasn't. And so class rank isn't even though it's one of the questions that's on all those questionnaires, it's not really something that they go by. Across the board, a test that is the same for every student in America is the ACT. And they also ask for SATs as well, but ACT in this area seems to be the majority one. And so if you got a 25 on your ACT, that's going to be pretty comparable to some kid in California who also got a 25 on his ACT. You're probably, and at least as a test taker, pretty decent, pretty comparable person in terms of a student. And that's really the only thing that they have to go by in terms of something consistent across the board. And it also, we also experienced this. My son had a 24 or 23 on his ACT. He was content with that. We were not, because the one more point got more scholarship money. And so we made him take it again. And he actually ended up getting a composite, a super score. The composite and the super score ended up being the same thing. I was hoping it would be higher, but I think it worked out to be a 25, which actually increased the merit or academic scholarship another $6,000. And so every point, they will find more, that you'll get more money. They will have president scholarships. They'll have all kinds of opportunities like that. And so you're going to add your academic scholarships to what you get athletically, or if you don't get anything athletically, you're still going to get scholarships if your coursework is your highest priority. And that has to be your highest priority. It really does. I mean, you will open up your opportunities to play college baseball so much more if you're a good student. If you're not a good student, the student I already told you guys about, one of the best players I've ever coached couldn't play in college because he wasn't a good student. And I can't emphasize that enough. I cannot emphasize that enough. You've got to take that serious. You will not play in college if you're not a good student, because college is grueling as an academic institution. And so so I know right now parents are saying amen, listen to this, right? Bumping your kids. But it's the honest truth. You have to do that. So go ahead.
The time to do that is the so-called off season, if there is such a thing. In the spring, you get your nose to the grindstone, with baseball. So just like you'd be in the weight room and all that stuff, fall, winter, whatever, you need to be doing, you need to spruce up this academic stuff as mm-hmm. best you can. That might mean a retake of the ACT or school year and student requires the SAT, you can take the PS, the pre-SAT, And my son did that a number of times. He had a wonderful teacher in junior high school that said, you know, encourage them to take it early so they'd be test ready, test familiar.
A pleasant surprise for us was, and this is another pro in taking, you know, in the pros and cons of taking the test more or less, another positive in taking the test numerous times is that most of the schools that we attended actually accepted a super score, which means if the first time he took it, he got a 22 in the mathematics section, but he got a 27 in the writing. But the second time he took it, he got a 25 in the mathematics, but a 19 in the writing. They would take the best of those two different tests. And so I think he ended up taking it four times. And like I said, the super score ended up being the same as his composite on his final time. But that could be a really, I mean, if you're really strong in one subject but weak in another, you could go ahead and take it again and just try to really spruce up that one subject that you're weak in, because you already know you've got a 29 on, you know, on this other subject. And so that super score is a real thing that most colleges, the ones that we visited, they accepted that. And we actually visited, I said he had four offers, but we probably visited 16, 17 schools. So after you, I mentioned if you know your major course of study, this is not absolutely necessary, but if you do, that narrows down your focus. And I'll tell you how you can filter your focus here in just a minute. But begin by make lists of schools to pursue. And you know, we talked about all the different schools. The advantage that you guys have today is you go online and you can go to these websites that filter by geography and major and sports. There's one called startclass.com. We're going to put a list of these links on here. In fact, I'll just go ahead and go to it right now so you can see it. A couple of these resources, that's not one of them, sorry. There's startclass.com, there's Niche, I think, N-I-C-H-E. But all I can't think well of the names of them are right now, but if you Google college search and then or college search by sport, this Start Class website was phenomenal. I went to that and it basically we made a list of, well, the first thing we did was said schools in the United States that have exercise science. And then over here you could say, well, schools that have baseball and exercise science. And you know, he actually, after visiting a few schools, he wanted to focus on schools of certain size. And so he actually preferred the smaller school. And so we just put average attendance and or average enrollment. We would, you know, it was basically right around 3,000 or less. And so that narrowed it down. And so we just kept narrowing it down. And then, you know, we put a map of a radius of how many miles away from home. And for him, in my particular case, he didn't care how far away from home he went, which is why I'm thankful he chose where he chose, because it's actually the closest of all of them that we visited. But there are lots of really cool things you could do with that. Go ahead and start playing with that and find schools, because what you're doing is you're making a list of schools that you're going to go on their websites to find information about their coaching staff, find their coaches' emails, and then you're going to make a list of the coaches' emails, and you're going to get ready to make personal contact with these coaches. You're going to make personal contact with these coaches. And so make sure that when you do that, you know, a lot of people wouldn't include all the levels in their search until they got the information that we gave you earlier in our little introduction about the value of playing D3, D2, NAIA, you know, JUCO, and all of these. So include all of those levels. Then go to the school websites. Go to their athletic website. And on every athletic website these days, I mean, I don't think you can find a college that doesn't have an athletic website now. If you do, maybe it tells you don't want to go there. But you will go to their baseball section on their website, because every athletic website has all the sports that they carry, and every sport has its own questionnaire. So on the baseball section of the website, you're looking for words like prospect questionnaire or online questionnaire, or you know, and they mostly say prospect questionnaire or questionnaire. And what you're going to start doing, and this is the tedious, long, same thing, typing the same thing over and over and over again thing, but once you have your list of schools, and if it's 50 schools, fill out 50 questionnaires. Go ahead and start filling out as many online prospect questionnaires as you possibly can, because that is the first way that you're getting your name and your information out to these coaches. You're actually starting to take initiative to say, I want to come to your school. And the first thing that you're doing is you're filling out the questionnaire that the coach has already put together that he feels is important. In 1990, when I was trying to play college baseball, we didn't have these kinds of things. What we had was these little blue cards. I remember from Marietta College, you get this little blue card in the mail that said, here's our questionnaire, we'd like you to fill this out. I would fill it out with a pencil or pen, put it in an envelope that I had to put a stamp on and send it over to Coach Shally and Marietta or Rio Grande or wherever we sent these to. And there weren't very many of those. I mean, we had to ask for them or search for them. Well, now you can get hundreds and hundreds of these filled out, but it does take time. And a lot of them are the same. A lot of them. So what I had Brock do was I said, okay, because some of the questions they're asking is, what are some of your accolades? Like, what did you know? Give me some of your numbers from last summer, things like that. You know, and so for those kinds of answers, I had them just make a note, like on your phone. There's the notes app. With the same thing, and then just copy and paste all that, because I helped him with these. This is something I did help him with, all right, because I knew it was a hard thing, and it was all just basic information, his name, phone number, things like that, and then there wasn't any essays for you to write your own opinions. But those online questionnaires are a first step, and then make your own highlight video. Highlight videos are the way to go these days. And the reason why is because that is going to be the only way a coach is going to actually see you play, most likely, unless you're playing summer ball and you are actively going around and trying to, your summer ball team is playing in tournaments where these coaches are going to be. You are most likely going to have to put your skills in front of the coach through video first. That's going to be the primary way that he's going to see you. And so now you're going, oh crap, how do we do that? Well, that's why we're here. We want to show you. We want to tell you. We want to tell you how it's easy.
Think about that. It's really to your advantage, isn't it? Because coach is going to show you, you know, how to put this together. Because in the old days, and even if they go to one of these travel games or whatever, yeah, you might be 0-for-3. You might not, you may not be able to find the plate that day on the mound or whatever. So you may not be your best foot forward. So having this tape gives an idea of, you know, what you can do. And they can focus in on that. And, you know, coaches have savvy. They can look and see.
Absolutely. And actually, I'll bounce off of something that you just said, and it's going to sound like I'm disagreeing with you, but I'm not. He doesn't care if you go 0-for-3. These college coaches are more interested in your projectability, not your productivity. When they come to watch these games, and this is, I actually had a coach tell me that, I mean, the union head coach told me that face-to-face. He's like, these guys think that when we come to see them play, if they don't go 2-for-3 or, you know, or hit a home run or throw a no-hitter or whatever, they're not going to get recruited. That's not what we're looking for. We're looking for a guy that plays hard, that has the tangibles and the intangibles, and we can see by watching him play that he's going to be a good college player. Because everybody goes 0-for-3 sometime. Everybody gives up home runs on the mound. Everybody walks batters. But that's you know, so what that does for you is it relieves that pressure of having to perform when those coaches are there. Your performance is busting your behind on and off the field, yeah, helping in any way you can. You know, if your team needs a bullpen catcher, you're the first guy to go out and do that in between innings. You're hustling. You run a hard 90. This is one of our buzzwords in Athens this year: hard 90, hard 90, hard 90. And the reason why that's such a must for every player who wants to play college baseball is because every coach has a stopwatch he takes with them to these games when he watches people play. And one of the things they do is they time how long it takes you to get out of the box in the first base. So some of that is about you having speed, but some of it is about you just hustling as well. Because there are guys that have the speed to get down there in 4.2, but they just don't do it. But there are guys that they can see, this guy doesn't have the speed, but he's busting his tail the whole way down. That's the player I want. And that's what they're looking for when they come to watch you play. Now, granted, it is better when you succeed, but it's not a deal breaker if you don't. And that's a beautiful thing to understand. And so I'm going to show you three different videos. They're not long, because that's one of the aspects about making these videos. And these are videos that there are two different kinds. Two of them are going to be showcase style videos, where we actually went out, we set up cameras on the field, and we put two different angles. This isn't something that I just did. I researched this and found out how to do this. Hey, Dave.
We sit here for a few minutes.
Yeah. And figured out and found out how to do this in order to get the most possible, you know, the best possible angles and things like that. And so what I'm going to do is we did this for a number of players, and some of the film came out good, some of it didn't. I did it a couple different times with my own son, and so for him, because he's a catcher, you're going to see the specific position of catcher. This is actually a little longer video than most of the videos would be. Most of the videos, like position specific, would be about a minute 30 seconds, and that's it, because that's all the coach has time to look at. He is looking at a lot of video, because that's one of the ways that a lot of people know that they're getting their skills out in front of you today. So I'll show you that different angles and things. First of all, this right here. That's a pretty important piece. Taking 10-15 seconds and putting his information there. And this is just, there's one angle, and then I'm going to show the same exact throw from behind second base. So you can actually get the pop time on that throw. And so we threw it like five or six times. So there's an angle. What the coach is looking at there is he's able to see his footwork from the side. And again, pop. Pop. Not a very good throw, actually, but compared to what I've seen him do this year. But this is just real simple, real quick, five or six throws. And I'll tell you, from watching this, the recruiting coordinator from Alderson Broaddus emailed Brock back, because he included these videos in his.
I mentioned the picture.
Yeah, he's starring in there, co-starring. But he sent the link to the video when he sent his email to him. He got the personal email back, because one of the questions he asked was, even if you're not recruiting in my position, would you evaluate my skills and tell me what I need to work on? And Coach Oster, who's actually Ron Oster's son, emailed him back, talked about his receiving, talked about his footwork. Talked about, basically said, actually, and from that, just from this video, he said, we actually would like for you to come over and work out. We like what we saw, and we are actually recruiting catchers in your class. We're in need of catchers for your class, and so we want you to come. And so we just put together, a couple of things. That was not a block and recover, even though it said block and recover. But there will be recovering here in just a little bit. So, and I can tell, the cool thing about it, I'm watching this right now thinking, wow, that's slow. Because he's worked his butt off over the last several months, and he's gotten a lot quicker this footwork as well. But at that point right here, it was enough for them to see and say, come on campus and let's work you out and let's do this. But this, like I said, this video is a little longer than the other positions because of so many different things that we showcase with catchers. So let me stop that and move on to a sample of our pitchers video, if I can get to it. This is Brody Rogers' pitching video that we did on the same day. Did this angle from behind. Now, not only is, we actually used a little bit of this film for Brock as well, because it's a different view of receiving, actually receiving one of our pitchers instead of receiving Kyle.
That's Matt Brody.
Which we basically just standing behind him, telling him what pitch to throw. He's calling it to the catcher, and we're giving him, that angle so that the coach can see his body, his stature, his mechanics, and they can see the path of the ball. And then after seeing a few of these pitches from this angle, you'll see a side angle so that you can see more of his mechanics from the side as well. I think this video
Yeah, that's a good looking pitch. Whoops.
Nice pitch, Brody.
This video is about 2.5 minutes long. Yeah, there's the other angle we got. So I put a GoPro out here and then used that camcorder that we're using tonight for the view behind them, so they could see that. Now, those are showcase style videos that you can do if you have a camera, a tripod, and a couple people to go out and help you do it. That's all it takes. You don't need to. We did two camera angles, but you really don't need two camera angles. We could have just done the one, like for the catcher, the one view behind that we panned out, and for the pitcher, the view behind it. Or we could have taken the same camera and moved it and did it that way, and then spliced the video up. The reason we're encouraging you guys to do this is because I have seen recruiting companies offer for a small fee of $300 to do this for you. And they come out and they do the same thing that you could do. You guys could, if you got your own camera, you could do this. You could get a friend, a coach, and another friend, and they can do this. I mean, you may not have the technology, you might have to call someone to help you, you know, actually piece it all together or whatever, you know, once you have the film, once you have the film clips. But if you, and you know, these days, man, you guys, if you know, if iMovie or Windows Movie Maker, or there's free ones online that you can get, heck, YouTube helps you make a video. There's a guy on our summer team that made his videos on YouTube. I mean, and YouTube is free. You upload the video, and you click on editor, and you just splice it. You splice it where you want to splice it, and you've got your own recruitment video. It is something that I wish that I could have had when I was your age. It's an unbelievable advantage that you have right now. So those are the showcase style videos. Now, what we do at Athens High School, and then also I've taken this around to our summer program as well, is we film every game. And so that's an advantage for guys that go to our school, because they can get this film from me if they want. Now, I'm not going to make everybody's own video for them. And we'll talk a little bit about the responsibilities of high school coaches, parents, kids, summer coaches, and all that. But I will give you the video. I'll support you in your quest to play in college. I'll help in whatever way you need me to. But if you know what I did for like all the kids on our summer team this past summer, we filmed all of our games. They all wanted the film because they wanted to put their own video together. So I said, bring me a 2 terabyte hard drive, USB hard drive, and I'll dump every game film on there for you. And you've got it. And you can. You know, some guys went and made their own video. Some people hired someone to look through, but they still have to. You gotta find the clips you want. You know, you want to put your best video clips at the front, and you don't want to just show them everything. You want to show them the your best things. If you do something really phenomenal, go ahead and put the whole game on film and let them see that. This past summer, Brendan Sano threw a perfect game against the Ohio Longhorns, one of the top-notch summer teams in Ohio up at Worcester College. And we filmed that whole game. Brock happened to catch that game, so it was a game that Brendan pitched, Brock caught. You could see in-between inning stuff, how they hustled, what kinds of things they did. So I put that entire game, 2.5 hour game, well, 2 hours and 15 minutes, on YouTube, and that's another link that they sent. He and Brendan both sent out and said, hey, if you want to see one of our, you know, just an entire game, you know, and filter through, you know, work through and see how things, you know, how we did things, here's a link to that. How did we film it? We use a GoPro. GoPro's going to be, you don't have to use a GoPro though. I could put that camera on this. There's a different piece that's a little bit longer right here that camera would fit on, and we could film with any old camcorder. I like the GoPro because you can do the wide angle lens, and no matter how close the backstop is, we could see the foul poles, and you can create that look. And so this GoPro is a GoPro Hero 4. It's $299 is what it cost me on eBay. I think they actually run around $350. I just got a great deal. This thing here is called a Link Spider, and I'll pass this around, and you guys can because there's a little one of those UPC codes or whatever. You know, what's it called? What do you call that code? So if you have one of those things, like scanners on your phone, you could actually go to this website right here. This thing is $50. This contraption is $50. And for a baseball game, to be able to hang this on the fence, right behind the umpire, right behind the the catcher's view right there and tighten it down. It's not moving anywhere. The reason why I like the GoPro is because this thing gets hit by foul balls a lot, hasn't phased it. If that got hit by foul balls, it would phase it. And so I moved to the GoPro version of this. Now that, when I used it, I pulled it back away from the fence so that it wouldn't get hit. But it means I had some of the fence in my view. The reason I like this thing is because when you're watching this film here in just a minute, you're not going to see any fence links, maybe just a little bit on there. And so what we did was, I'll pass this around while I show this video. What we did was, we filmed all the games. So this is me taking Brock's own clips, and this is where parental involvement can come in. You guys can sit down and make these videos together. It's not that you can't do anything, it's just that don't talk to the coaches for them. Let the kids do the talking. You help them and support them with these things. I mean, I helped him make this video, and he's the one that picked out the clips he wanted. And so what we did with this is the live game video, and this is what the video looks like from the GoPro on the, this is from last summer, actually. Game from last summer. And again, put your best clips up front. So we put all those home runs and things like that up front on these films. I don't think that was a home run. I think it was must have been a double in the gap. But these, you know, that, again, you don't see any fence posts, fence links or whatever. We played 7 out of the 10 tournaments. We played the summer wood bat tournament, so a lot of these sounds are going to be wood bats. But what we did with the game film is we put, because it's, we wanted to basically to make it one video with the game highlights, we put hitting and catching in the same film, so it's a little bit longer. This one's about 3 minutes, and you'll see different angles just because of what the different kinds of backstops and things. That's Grove City High School. But they don't even have to be, one of the reasons why I kept, like, whenever there was a double and I kept it on there is because I wanted the, you know, if he ran it hard, I wanted him to see that he's running the ball, you know, running it out hard, you know, trying to let down a double, because he's not the fastest guy, all right, he's a bigger guy, but he does run the bases hard. And so, yeah, you'll get all kinds of clips like this of yourself, and you can make your own video. You can see in summer ball, some of these fields are absolutely beautiful to play on. This is summer baseball right here. And these are, a lot of these are college programs. This is Mount Union, so that's a D3 school. And when we go and play on these college campuses, these coaches are always there. The Mount Union coach is there getting this field ready beforehand. He comes over and talks to the kids. This is a high school. I love that angle, though. That's a closer fence. It's a high school in Franklin, Ohio, I think. There's UC. We're talking about UC. A little bit of everything. You know, show yourself going to the backside. Show yourself pulling the ball a little bit. If you're a hitter, if you want to put a hitting film together. Show line drives up the middle. If you bunt, I think actually he doesn't bunt, but he can do it effectively. So we put that on there as well. So we did some live catching as well. There isn't a lot of clips on there, but if you're a pitcher, like for some of the pitchers, you want to get some of the better, like that's not a very good film because the sun is coming into the view. This would be a lot better look for a pitcher. That wasn't good for a pitcher, but it was good for the catcher. Anyway, I'll stop that there. So that's one of the ways that you can, that's one of the most valuable things that you can do right now is start putting film together, start making your own film, all right? And so this is to continue that list of what you should be doing right now. Go to some of these free websites and go ahead and create an online profile because that'll give you a place to host some of your information. Your stats, which I'll tell you this, when we talk about honesty, stats really aren't that big of a deal to baseball coaches. And one of the reasons is because baseball stats are very subjective depending on who's keeping them. What might be a hit for one dad is not a hit for another dad or for somebody else that's keeping the stats. And so batting average really has no bearing on whether or not you're going to play in college. Now, if all of your teams that you've played on, and he looks at your stats, it doesn't mean you shouldn't include stats. You will include stats. They'll ask you about stats, but they're not they're not taking you because of stats. If they notice that every team you played on, you hit over 600, you're pretty darn good hitter. All right, there's not, you can't fudge that much. All right, but, and so that's, there is some value to it, but it's not all about stats. But what these recruiting websites will do is they'll give you a chance to create a profile online. That's just two of them. There's a bunch of them out there. I just grabbed two of them that have pretty good baseball sections on them. Field level is you got to be part of the team, but you, depending on what team you're on, high school or college, or high school or summer ball, you can determine who your coach is. And then what happens there is a college coach will contact a high school coach and say, hey, I'm interested in recruiting so-and-so. Would you release his information to me? They can't see your information until they contact the college coach and or the high school coach or the summer ball coach or whoever it is that you're under, and then they'll do that. Don't feel bad if you haven't had that happen and you're a freshman or a sophomore, because I know like some of you guys already have a profile on our on field level, but these guys they know what they're looking for. And if they're going to field level, they're looking for some last-minute guys that haven't committed yet. So a lot of times what I do, I just got one last week. In fact, I had a coach ask me if I would release information for Waylon Bradbury. And so I just released information for him to that college coach. And Waylon actually got a text from him. And it was a pretty cool experience for him because that guy had a need and he saw his video. We made a video for him and we put it up there. That's the cool thing about be recruited in field level, the two that I'm really familiar with, I'm not familiar with all the other ones, but is you can just put your video links right there and they can go to your profile, they can see everything about you, watch your video. And the other thing that field level does is it allows me as a high school coach or me as a summer ball coach to be able to put an assessment of you on there that only the college coaches can see. And so a high school coach should be able to be honest with you. Like if you come to me and ask me, where do you think I fit? I should tell you the honest truth. So all your high school coaches should do that. But sometimes it might be harder because people don't want to hurt people's feelings, right? So they can put an assessment on there that's really honest about you. And I'm telling you that if I put an assessment on there about any of our guys, I will also tell you what I wrote on there. And I've done that with some of the older guys that have gone on now that aren't using field level anymore. But one of the most, so the video is one of the most important things, and I'll say one of the second most important things is to go ahead and start drafting your email that you're going to use to reach out to these coaches. And so I'm going to go to the next page because I want to show you a sample email, and I'm actually going to show you the email that Brock sent to Oliver Sombradas the first time he reached out to them. I think this was the first time he reached out to them. And I will also tell you that he sent out probably 60 of these, and they were not form letters. Do not just make one email and send it out to every coach that you want to contact. It takes time. You need to go, this is why you go to their website and you go to their baseball page and you go to their bio page and you read about that coach, how long he's been at that school, how many wins he has, what kind of season they had last year, what players have gone on to play in the bigs, some accolades that he's had, and you include some of those things about what you've read in your email. You learn a little bit about their school and talk to them about why you want to go to their school. And you say, I really I love the campus. I've never visited the campus, but I'd love to come and visit because the pictures I see online are phenomenal. It's a rustic area and I love to fish and I see that there's a river with rapids. I'm kind of thinking about where AB is right now. And those are some of the things that he talked about. Well, Brock, as I mentioned, already knew what he wanted to major in. And so if you can't read that, I'll just tell you. Hi, Coach Yurich and Coach Oster. That's the head coach and the recruiting coordinator. He limited to those two guys or a couple other assistants that I think were listed on the website, but their emails weren't on there. Some of the schools that he sent emails to, he sent the email to six coaches because I told him to send it to every coach that's on that you can find an email for that team, because the head coach will get 60 of these a day and he's probably not going to read them, or he's not going to read them all, but somebody will. One of those other coaches will. Most of the time, the head coach is not the recruiting coordinator. And so, when you go online, you'll find out who the recruiting coordinator is, and you definitely want to make sure he's in that list, but I would put them all there. I'd put the grad assistants, the groundskeeper, if he's listed, everybody. Just put them all in the email, right? And then this is the subject heading of the email, just his name, what year he's graduating, and what position he plays. And that's the, and that's because, again, you're narrowing it down for them. If they're not recruiting in his class, it just right away tells them, we're not recruiting catchers. And they may reply back and say, we're not recruiting catchers in your class. They may not. But you move on. You keep contacting other ones. Because you throw your lines out there, eventually you're going to catch one, right? And that's what he did here. He threw 60 lines out and he cut about six. And this was the one that ended up being the best offer for him. So what it says is, hi, Coach Urish and Coach Oster. I'm a 2017 catcher, my primary position. I also play some third base and pitcher. And I'm interested in attending Alderson Broaddus and especially playing baseball for you. In my research, I have found that Alderson Broaddus has an excellent exercise science program, which is what I intend to major in. And it has always been my dream to play college baseball. I'm committed to working as hard as I can, or as hard as it takes to fulfill that dream. Though a few schools have shown some interest in me, I'm still uncommitted and narrowing my focus on schools with quality exercise science programs. I plan to attend your showcase on October 9th. So this was an open showcase event that he went to, which was the first time he went on campus. We actually went on campus three times to AB, or two times. The second time was an actual recruiting official visit where they invited him on. He actually spent the night with some players and things like that. But I would first like to ask, so that's a good question. I'm not going to waste my money and come to your showcase camp unless you're recruiting still for the 2017 class. So are you still recruiting for your 2017 class? And more specifically, are you recruiting catchers? And that narrows it down again. Because like I said, some of the other coaches that he asked that question to were kind enough to reply back and say, thank you for reaching out to us, but we're not recruiting catchers in your class. Okay, I know I don't want to go to your school then. I mean, it made it that easy, right? If I want to play baseball, then as great as your school may be, that's off my list now. And now, if I didn't want to play baseball and I really love that school, that's the number one thing. If you really love that school and you're okay with not playing baseball, well, go to that school because that's what it's about. You're there to get an education, right? But he knew baseball was a big part of the equation for him, and he wants to do both. He wants to get the education and play baseball. And so if they were recruiting catchers, that's a bonus. That means we've got an opportunity here. So I have attached a YouTube playlist. So we put all of his, yeah, actually, we've been creating videos for a few years now. So he has a playlist on YouTube, and the best ones were at the top of that playlist. I've included a YouTube playlist of all my video links of game films, catching skills, and hitting. There are a few complete game videos, like I mentioned to you guys about the perfect game and things like that, with no editing, so they can see the in-between innings. If you think I would be a good fit, speaking their language, for your program and your 2017 recruiting class, then I'm willing to do whatever it takes to get there. Either way, I would love to hear your evaluation of me. So either way, even if you're not recruiting me, I would love to hear your evaluation of me after watching my videos so that I can continue to work on areas where improvement is needed. What I told Brock to do was I said, put something in your email that will invite them to reply back to you. Not obligate them, because they're not obligated to do anything. But something, you know, ask a question like that. Say, hey, if you see my video and I really want to be the best I can be and I really want to play in college, most college coaches, and it's like Steve and I, we don't have to be here, but we want to see guys get to play in college. Most college coaches want to see more people play in college, and so they will help you. They will give you, you know, this kind of information. And I find it to be especially true. I'm not in the world of football or basketball or soccer or volleyball or whatever. Dave's been in basketball. He's going to talk a little bit here and offer, if you'd like to talk a little bit, I'll let you do that. Yes. Offer some thoughts. But I'll tell you this: in the world of baseball, these coaches are awesome. They're phenomenal. They don't, and if you don't choose to come to my school, that's okay. Where do you want to go? I'll give that guy a call for you. I've had coaches say that. I'll give this guy a call for you on your behalf. I mean, there are some really good guys in this fraternity of coaches. And so anyway, again, so the YouTube information is there, and the last paragraph says you can also view info about me on my field level profile, and then that link is right there in the email. And I play for the Midwest Marlins, which is the summer team, and can be contacted through Coach Weaver. Again, not my information, because in this scenario, I'm not just his high school coach, I'm his dad. So I asked him to put a summer ball coach information on there. You guys can put my information on there. You guys can put Steve's information on there. Your own high school, go to your own high school coach and say, do you care if I use you? Of course, they're gonna allow you to do that. And then here's my cell phone number as well. Thank you so much for considering me. I look forward to hearing from you. As I told you earlier, they did watch the videos. he did get an email back, and then he ended up getting a text back and an invite back, and that's where the ball got rolling for him, and it worked out. It worked out. And so that's the kind of email that you want to make. So let me talk about some of the elements that are in that email, and this is what I would encourage you to include in your email. First, don't make it a form letter. Don't send the same email to everybody. Now, there were a lot of elements about this that were the same that we sent to everybody. But that first paragraph was pretty well personalized for every school that he contacted. Every coach, every school, he went out and did the research and figured out what he wanted to say. That was a personal touch there. And so don't make it a form letter. Include info about you, where you play high school ball, your graduation year, your summer ball positions, your height, your weight, things like that. Just general information about you. Some baseball measurables, like your 60 time, if you've got that, if you know it, your pop time. We didn't include that necessarily in the email because he had the video links there. But if you don't have videos and you want to send out something, go ahead and include some of these numbers, right? Your velocity, if you're a pitcher, it is an important thing to college coaches. You're not going to pitch the D1 level unless you're 88, 89, okay? You're just not. You're not. Unless you're 85 with a phenomenal curveball that really gets people out and a change, a couple different pitches with different arm slots and whatever. But it doesn't mean that you're not going to see great pitching in D2. It's just that their D2 may have one guy that throws 90, but a bunch of guys that throw 84. And that may be the better fit, things like that. Anything noteworthy about your teams that you've played on? Like, were you know, like one of the things he was able to include after last year was we were district champions and we're one game away from the state semifinal and things like that. So they know you're playing on a competitive team. You're not just winning your league. They don't know anything about your league, but you're competitive. You know, and then about your summer team. Try to get on the most competitive summer team that you can get on because a lot of these coaches know the names of these teams. When a kid says he plays for Ohio Elite, they perk up because they know a lot of kids have gone to play ball from Ohio Elite. Like I mentioned, the Longhorns and Indiana Nitro, another team that we saw in the video there that we were playing against, and some other younger upcoming organizations have sent a lot of players to play. The team that Rocket plays on, it's one of the reasons why we chose it is because it's one of the closest geographic teams, the Midwest Marlins out of Lancaster. The team that he's on this year will be the second 18U team to finish, to go through. Last year's 18U team was the first team, I think, or 2 years ago, was the first team to go through from like 14 and up. There are 17 guys on his roster for his 18U team, summer ball team, and 16 of the 17 are committed to playing college somewhere. And so that's a good program. And that's also what that tells you, which is a point we're going to make here in a little bit, that's a lot different than your high school team. There may be nobody committed to play. I mean, there may be one at the most. You've got to play summer ball. You have to play club ball. You just have to. You can't expect them to be able to see you play if you don't play club ball or summer ball. It's I would say it's essential. And it can be done while playing other sports. In fact, I think baseball is very easily done while playing other sports because on our team in particular, if you can't make it next weekend, that's fine. We got plenty of guys that can, right? But show us what weekends you can be there, and we'll plug you in, make sure you're on the roster and you're playing because you got football camp or you've got basketball camp or whatever. There are a lot of guys on this team are three-sport athletes. It doesn't mean that you have to commit just to one sport. It just means that you got to look for other options. You got to look for the options that are out there. It's one of the reasons why we were talking about American Legion dying. I think that's one of the reasons why American Legion has deteriorated because they wouldn't budge on that. You got to be here all the time. And we don't live in that world anymore. It's a different world. So we'll help you out with the email later too. If you guys, we'll give you our contact information if you want some more specifics. Some other important realities I would say, Steve, jump in whenever you want. Like we've talked about this, be realistic, all right? Be realistic. D1 is not the best option for 95% of high school players because it's only about 5% of high school players that go and play D1 baseball. And so that's you know, the way for you to be realistic is to ask other people's advice, not your parents. They're going to tell you you're the greatest, right? Ask other coaches, your high school coach, ask other high school coaches. Ask people who you know will be honest with you about your evaluation, about what level they think you can play at. It's not always an easy conversation to both for both the coach and for you to hear, but it's something that is very needed because it's going to help keep you from wasting a bunch of time in this whole process, because it's a great process. But if you already know where you are and you've already embraced the idea that, okay, I need to cast my net in the D3 world, in the D2 world, the NAIA world, in the JUCO world. And it doesn't mean I should ignore the D1 world. Go for it. Dream big. But understand that there's a lot more opportunity out there that's really good opportunity. And so be realistic. I said you got to do it. You got to play some of the ball. You just have to. I have never, in the world of baseball, I don't think I've ever seen a player go play college ball that didn't play summer ball. And there are a couple reasons I say this is so important. One, we've already said it, college coaches can't see you play unless you play in the summer, because they will never come to your game in the spring. They're never going to come to see you play in high school. The only time I think I ever saw a college coach see us play was when we played on their field. So district tournament at OU, if they happened to be in town, OU coaches were there. That's it. They're playing when you're playing, and they're busy. It's not their recruiting time right now. And so it doesn't mean they don't do it. They'll do some. If there's a guy in their area that they know is somebody they want to snatch up, they'll find a way to get somebody out there. But for the most part, that's not the best time for them. Summer is the best time. Fall is the best time for them to get you on their campus. But summertime, especially when it's kind of open season or off season for all sports, that's when they can get out there. The second reason I would say you got to play summer ball is this. If you don't play summer ball, then you're going to have to be prepared to answer the question, why don't you play summer ball, when the college coach asks you that. I heard a college coach ask a player, an aspiring college baseball player, that question. When he said he didn't play summer ball, the coach said, why didn't you play summer ball? The answer was, because I've got basketball all June and I've got football all July and there's no time to fit it in. That's really unfortunate, one, that he felt that way. If it was a reality or not, that he didn't think he had any option at all playing summer baseball because he had to, and it's the truth, it really is. I mean, almost every weekend in June is filled with basketball, almost every weekend in July, or every week in July is filled with football. But I did it. I worked out with football in the morning, had a job in the afternoon, had a baseball game in the evening. I was beat by the time I went to bed that night, but it can be done. It can be done. If you want to play, sometimes, and those are some choices that you may have to make. Like I mentioned, this year Brock decided not to play football. It was a really hard choice for him. But he only decided not to play football because he knew he wasn't where he needed to be in the recruiting process. And it was something he really wanted to do. And so it was a tough, tough decision, but it's paying off. And again, I will never tell you to stop playing other sports. That's why you should start early. Start earlier than we did, so you don't get into that situation. So, showcases and prospect camps, PBR, $375 showcases. Should I go to them? Things like that. The big showcases where have you all heard of PBR? Have any of you gone to a PBR yet event? We did two. And we only did two. I should say we did one and a half. We did two because the first one, we were going to do one. And the first one he went to at Ohio State, a huge storm rolled in right in the middle of their game, which is the last thing they do. They do all the showcase stuff and they play a game, if it's one of those prospect games things. And they gave everybody a rain check for a free time to come back and do it again at your time of choosing. And so we actually went to another one for free, which was at Wright State, and those were the only two that we went to. And I learned something when I was there, watching these 400 kids herded out there like cattle, and running from home to first, and hitting five balls on from BP, and hitting off the tee, and having a guy sit behind him with a radar gun with an exit velo, and watching kids with terrible form just swinging as hard as they can because they know that all that's going to be put on the website is that number, not anything else, just that number, and the higher the velo, the better, and things like that. And it's just one after another, after another, after another, after another. And they are a well-oiled machine, this group is. They have guys videotaping, filming, taking notes. They're already on the website, doing your profile and all that. And what I learned is, yeah, it's a good experience. So if you've got the money to do it one time. But here's what I would say from my opinion and my perspective, those camps are the most beneficial for the top 5% of the kids that go to them. are the only ones that are going to get talked to by those college coaches. The majority of the kids that were at that camp, there may have been one or two that really stood out. And those are the ones that got all the attention. Everybody else just got lost in the crowd. And granted, you have that profile, you know, on PBR's website and things like that, but if you didn't have a good day, you don't want to send anybody your profile. You don't want to send anybody your, you know, I mean, and so here you spend a lot of money for something that probably isn't going to be that beneficial. So I will say this, it is a good experience, because the more showcase type stuff you go to, the more comfortable you're going to be with what happens when you do showcase your skills in front of a college coach. Because when Brock went to Union, there was not a showcase prospect camp. It was a personal invite visit, and so it was just him and the coaches and a couple of players that got out there to work out with him. And so he did the same thing he would do at a showcase, but he was comfortable with it because he'd been at a couple showcases. So he ran, he did his pop time, he blocked, he received, he hit, and all that, and then he talked to the coaches. And it was just a one-on-one deal there. And so it was good to have that experience. But I will say this, you can blow a lot of money in this with those big time showcases and not have it be as beneficial as what doing some of the other things we've talked about, narrowing down your search by looking at the colleges that you really want to pursue and finding out when they're doing their prospect camps. It might be talking about, you still got to pay for the prospect camp, but the difference you're looking at is $60 for some of these D2, D3 prospect camps. Now, some of the D1 camps, like OU's, is $250. It's expensive. And they kind of do the same thing. They pay their GAs, or, you know, their grad assistants and their volunteers. You know, a volunteer baseball coach on a college campus is getting paid. He's getting paid by these camps that they're running and their personal instruction they're providing. And so that's why some of these camps are pretty expensive. And again, the bigger it is, the more likelihood it's going to be you're going to get lost in that crowd. And so just keep that in mind, all right? I'm not saying you shouldn't go, you probably should get the experience, but that there's give and take to that. And the guys that really benefit from it are the ones that are going to be probably the D1 level guys that really stand out at these places.
So PBR, yeah.
Preps Baseball Report.
Yeah. And you know, so each college, they have their own prospect camp, is what you're saying.
Most of them do.
And then there are other listings, and some are private. I mean, you know, that are more into marketing.
Right.
You know, so one's more of, so there's a difference.
And even those colleges will sometimes invite other schools in the area. Like, we went to one at Lincoln Memorial University down in the Cumberland Gap. Beautiful campus. Wonderful school. Wonderful baseball school. And I was surprised. There was 90 kids there. It was a big one. I mean, that's big for a one, you know, a small school showcase. But they had, that's actually where the Union coach saw Brock. The Union Kentucky, because Union's not far from there. They had Union there. They had Tusculum there. They had Pfeiffer and some different. I mean, a bunch of schools were there. There were probably 6, 7, 8 different coaches there on Lincoln Memorial's campus, because they were like, "We're not going to take all these kids, so come and look at them." And so it was a lot more benefit. I mean, you can find some camps like that. Yeah. I think OU invites other coaches to come, don't they? I don't know if they do or not.
I think they do, but I guess I just wanted to make sure that people knew that how to find some of these, you know, showcases.
Yeah, if you want to,
And there's a difference between a camp and a showcase.
Right, yes, yeah. That usually on their websites, if you want to go to a showcase, you're going to look for the word showcase or prospect camp. If you might be disappointed if you sign up for a camp and then you later find out they weren't evaluating, it was just all instruction. There's an instructional camp that colleges often give, and they actually often promote those to the younger players. So sometimes elementary school and junior high players, but high school players can come to those as well. And some colleges combine them. We went to a couple camps. We went to a camp, actually the one in Cochran that Brock went to was an instructional / showcase. The coaches really got down and involved in helping the kids and things because they wanted to send them away with that value. There was some value to that, whether we want you to come to our campus or not as a player. So there is a good mix of that. We talked about the reality of college baseball players and scholarships. We talked about doing it yourself, you know, videos and contacts and things like that. We talked about JUCO being a great option for many. And then I guess the final thing for me, the last thing I want to say and emphasize is the ball is completely in your court or on your baseball field, I guess we should say, in your glove. It's up to you. And so, you know, just to reemphasize this point here of whose role things are, you know, different aspects of this is, it's, you know, I have heard, you know, being involved in a summer team, I have had the pleasure or displeasure of hearing some of the dads on that summer team berate their high school coaches. You know, I'm talking about kids that go to Pick Central or North or whatever, really get upset because his high school coach hadn't done anything for him. And my first question as a high school coach, my first question is, well, what has your son done? What, you know, what has he told the high school coach? What was he asked the high school coach to help him with? You know, well, and one of the responses was, well, he's the coach. You ought to be helping him get to college. And like, that's not the way it works. It is. I mean, it's not the high school coach's job to get your son into college. You know, it's not your job. I mean, yeah, we're there to support. But if you want to go to college, you got to do the work. You got to make the contacts. You got to put the initiative in. Because if you're not putting initiative in your own dream and your own effort, you know, in your own desire to go and play, that's speaking volumes to that college coach about what kind of person you're going to be and what kind of initiative you're going to take on their ball diamond and in their program to be the best player that you can be and to be the best representative and ambassador for that college and their program that you can be. And so I just broke this down into three parts. Your role is all the work. That's your role, players. All the work is that's you. The preparation, the communication, the initiative. You need to go out and do it. You need to be the one hitting Google and searching on those startclass.com and making those searches and things like that. You take the initiative, because I guarantee you do that, it's going to make your high school coach, your parents a lot more supportive in wanting to help you. If you're not taking the initiative, they've already been to college. They don't need to do this again. They don't need to go through this process again. So I would say parents' role to support all of your efforts. Coaches' role, support all of your efforts. But you know, if we expect travel ball coaches, high school coaches, or somebody else to do all the work to get us into college, we're going about it all the wrong way. It has to be the onus of responsibility is on the player to get to college. From getting out on the field and playing the right way, getting seen, getting noticed, getting yourself out there, your name out there on those questionnaires, you're on the emails, you know, getting some film done, and then the people that are surrounding you, that love you, that want to help you get there, they're there for the support, and that's a really valuable thing. So, I included from this website a timeline. That's what that other paper is there that says it's from highschoolbaseballweb.com, and I just want to show you what that website looks like. If you want to, that's a very valuable website. It's actually mostly high school coaches that get on there and talk, have message boards, things like that. There's a lot of good topics and good articles that are written, and that's just one of the articles. There's also another article, and I didn't include it here, but and we actually include it in our team manual at Athens High School. It's called "So You Want to Play College Baseball? What do college coaches? What's important to college coaches? Or what are some things that you may do or don't do that you don't think are important to college coaches?" And it's just a list of things. So we didn't leave as much time as we should have, but I'm Wendy. Anybody have any questions? What questions do you have? What did we not cover that you hope we do cover? Yeah.
On the about the videos.
Yeah.
Does the JV have a GoPro
to do
video JV games at Athens High School?
A GoPro, no. One of these, no.
And can we do that? Would that be something allowable?
You could do, yeah. Okay. Absolutely. If you want to get a system like that, we could do JV games. The other thing I was going to say is record every at bat that your son takes. So Sonny Sano, from the time Brendan was 11 years old, Sonny brought his little Sony camera and recorded every single at bat that Brendan took, and recorded, you know, I didn't record the whole game pitching, but would you can do it with your phone. I mean, this actually does pretty good video. Your phone does. I got one of the older ones, as you can tell. But, it, you know, there are other ways to do it. That's just one of, this is kind of the extreme way, sticking the camera up there and recording the whole game.
Okay.
But yeah, that's for, that, I mean, that's because I can't do it as a parent. If I were a parent, I may not do that whole thing. I may, if I were just in it for my own kid, I might just go up to the fence, and that way I don't have to filter through 2.5 hours every game of film, you know, but because I'm in the dugout.
Oh, I thought that, okay, so that.
Yeah.
That's not like a team. I guess I get a little, I only have the experience of, I guess, with that huddle.
Yeah, yeah, like
that
football.
That was very
does.
Easy, mm-hmm. So I only have, like, you have brought with Nicholas's experience. The videos go out, his profile, mm-hmm. and then with his academic
That's a really good system.
It really starts.
This, yeah.
And that doesn't.
Expensive system.
They don't have it. So this is our way, this is our avenue.
This is going to be our avenue.
That's
yeah.
our avenue.
Yeah. So. I think Huddle is, has opened up to baseball now, but you're talking $8,000 right. a year for the subscription for something like that. It's a very expensive system. Schools have to buy that pretty much for it to work. But yeah, any film. And I'd be glad to help give any advice on how to make a film too. So
there are a lot of good resources in the area, perhaps even in schools. So, and I can try
I'll
to
put that back up there too, so you guys can see.
But you were talking earlier about the difference when you go for baseball. It's a little bit similar to football and basketball. When I took him to University of Cincinnati last year, and they had probably 7 or 8 different coaches from other colleges there too.
Right.
I mean,
right.
So all of them are pretty similar.
I would say
it's a totally different sport. I think a lot of running trials. So.
Yeah, that's why we said that. I think a lot of the information can overlap a little bit. It's just that the majority of our knowledge base was, well, all of our knowledge base was going to come from baseball.
So. And you can see there's probably 10 or 15 kids that probably didn't pay to come. Was,
right.
They just paid all the attention to them.
Yep.
It's like,
yeah. You had a question too.
Just a real quick question. I mean, the videos and that type of thing that you're sending to these coaches, is there a line where it's like over the top? And they're
going to
really look at this and go, oh, yeah.
Yeah, I'm glad you asked that, because there are things you don't want to include with the videos. Don't put music over it. In fact, sound isn't even necessary, especially for basketball. Like, I did a video for my niece for basketball, and she ended up getting a scholarship also to play at a D2 school. And I told her, I said, I'll do 2 different ones for you. One for you to give to your friends that has, you know, the sound on it with some music behind it. But the other one is going to be the same video with no sound at all, because that can be annoying to coaches. And so for, like, you notice that there was sound on this. I do like it for baseball because you can hear the pop of the mitt and the pop of the other mitt. You can hear the pop of the bat. I wish there was a way to take some of the conversational sound, things like that, down. But
yeah, you have to be careful with the background.
I double and triple checked everything. Yeah, all the things that I'm sure people pay really close attention to where they sit at our baseball games because I'm filming them all. So yeah. Anybody else? Let me give you Steve and I's contact too, because I think that rec center closes.
Is that good enough?
Oh sure. Yeah.
Everybody wants to. You know,
we could send anything you want us to send.
You know, we'll keep you on the list if you want to network with us, or if you just want our information and let us know. Again, this is about 12 hours of seminar in 2, and you know, Chris obviously is much more recently involved and did a great job here.
High school players that go to play pro baseball is less than, it's less than 1%.
Yeah.
It's point something percent. So, you know, that everybody has that dream, but let's go ahead and burst that bubble.
Yeah,
right,
well, and that's just, would you be happy with this decision in 20 years? You know, because it may last you 4 years, 5 years, but, you know, when you start getting serious and you start narrowing this pool down and you're choosing the college, and it's hard to look that far ahead, I know, but in the distant future, what are the chances of me being really happy with this decision? In other words, if I go to play baseball in the major, I chose my second or third choice, might I be happy with that? So you gotta, all those things, you know, you gotta filter.
That's actually something I meant to say and forgot, and that is, don't choose your college based on it's baseball. Because if baseball gets taken away from you, you get injured, God forbid, you still gotta go to school there. I was actually very, very proud of that aspect of our search. You know, Brock took his time, and there's one of the things he actually said to me when I asked him, because I was actually, it's a kind of nerve-wracking process too, because we kept asking. He was getting close to Christmas, and we're like, have you decided yet? Because we've narrowed down at that point to three. And like, you know, what do you think? What are you thinking? You know, have you decided yet? And we wanted it to be completely his decision. And one of the things that he told us is about one of the schools that was on that list is he said, I really like this school. I really like this baseball program. But if I weren't playing baseball, I don't think I'd go to school there. And I said, take it off your list. You know, that it's narrowed down to two now, you know. And so yeah, that, I mean, that you've got to make the decision based on the academics.
In Brock's situation, they'll evaluate that scholarship yearly, correct?
Yes, it's not a guarantee.
It's not a guarantee. For,
yeah, you could go higher as well.
Go higher.
Right.
So that's why, you know, you got that good work ethic now. That's part of why.
Or lower. Higher or lower.
Yeah. It could be diminished too, but they count on that work ethic that in what they see as carrying on. But you know, you've got your first year, because sometimes you're sitting behind somebody. That's not unusual at all.
You're probably going to be
sitting behind. First year, you're probably going to be sitting behind someone, and then the academic rigors, you know, might find out that it's pretty taxing. So if you back off in your effort, in your, you know, the zeal that they caught your eye in the first place, it could impact that scholarship money. On the other hand, you know, as Chris said, it could be enhanced. It could be increased the next year. They want to keep you in that program. So, you know, all these things are, it's probably overwhelming now. We try to take a little bit of just kind of throw it out there now and let you, you know, you're going to be chewing off for quite a while. But hopefully you'll be, you know, kind of forewarned, you know, about some of the stuff. It may not be as, hopefully it won't be as overwhelming. But it can be a tremendous opportunity, as Dave was saying, you know, it's a big career decision. It's probably the most important decision you'll make, the college decision, you know, as a young person.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yeah.